So you should not, it has to be a subject that the local authorities are interested in hearing from the people without a predetermined conclusion. So that's why we're able to spread this in China, where in there are certain topics, obviously we wouldn't do this in China. But on the issues that we're discussing, they actually want to hear from the people about about the local budget or the choice of infrastructure projects, for example. So whatever the issue is in your case, it shouldn't be one where people think that, oh, the authority, there's a right answer and a wrong answer. It has to be open. Does that help? Yeah.
Yes. I wanted to ask you a question.
Concerning,
you know, during our discussion yesterday, you suggested to us that when we are carrying out something, when we go to the mayor, you suggested to us that we can inform him whether he has some people he would like to propose.
Oh, for the advisory group.
Or for the advisory
group. Oh, not the sample.
Particularly concerned because when it happens that they propose some number,
We never allow people to. No, then it wouldn't be a scientific sample.
To add to what Professor asked, so to what extent can the observers come in, especially when, let's say, it happens that the small group discussion, particularly all the groups, happens to be distorted from the real fact. Is it because they are observers, they cannot say anything, or so do we have a point where the observers can actually come in to clarify and then go back?
What we try to do is we try to do that in the plenary sessions. So in the plenary sessions, you have a balanced panel of experts where they can respond to each other. And if something is important in the small groups, it turns into a question in one or more of the groups, brought to the plenary session, and then the experts who are, will be partly composed by the advisory committee and partly nominated by the advisory committee. So you have an agreed set of experts who represent different points of view, then they will respond and then everybody will get the answers. Because you don't want different groups to get different facts. You want all the facts to be the same in all the groups, if you have 15 groups or 20 groups or whatever it is. So that way, everybody
that it reaches reported.
Yeah.
And you just said, when you calculate a sample size based on an expected assumption of difference that you could determine, because the assumption that it could be large, we need a sample size small, but if it's not large,
I'm talking about the change of opinion.
Yeah, change of opinion. Yeah. So the assumption is you expect it to be large, therefore your sample size relatively be smaller. But if for any reason that change of opinion is not large, but it could be meaningful, but your statistically you would not pick it up. I mean, have a situation like that, and how do you convince? Because you can post hoc work that if you were on the power.
Well, 250, 300 people actually works pretty well. We haven't had, and remember, at the end of the day, the media and observers and commentators, they like to focus on change. But what we're really interested in is the considered judgments at the end. What do the people want to do? So if before deliberation it's 65% support this policy, and after deliberation, 69% support, and if you had a larger sample that would turn up significant, we don't really care if you have a clear, strong majority. There will be, in terms of explaining, you know, and there's some regressions we can do to see what are the levers of opinion change supporting movement one way or the other. Yeah, it's always nice to have more, a bigger N, but there are practical constraints in these things. So we found in these 70-some projects that range of number is a pretty practical number and allows us both to evaluate, I mean, the two questions. The first is the representativeness of the sample in its attitudes, demographics, and then secondly,